He's the former Eagles quarterback. He's the former ESPN analyst. He's Ron Jaworski. Jaws back on the program. Jaws, how are you?
Dan, I'm doing terrific on a beautiful Monday in the Philadelphia area.
Well, except for the Eagles.
You are correct.
Okay.
The sky is falling. You know Philadelphia. The capital that has been built up from the Super Bowl victory appears to be gone.
Okay, biggest concern with the Eagles is what?
I think the fact that the defense is not a dominant defense. When I looked at this team coming into the season, I kind of felt with Carson coming back, it would take a little time for the offense to click. But I thought the real bedrock would be the defense, particularly the defensive line. They have been good, but not dominant. And as everyone knows, you know, pass defense is about coverage and pressure, being able to cover in the secondary and pressure the quarterback, get rid of the football quickly. And they just haven't been in sync in that regard. So what I thought would be the dominant aspect of the Eagles has not been thus far this season.
I want to ask you about the Cowboys and their offense or lack thereof. You had the 4th-and-1 last night, and I know that I have the benefit of the already knowing the end result, but if you have Ezekiel Elliott and you have that offensive line, or even if it's Dak Prescott, even if it's a long 1 yard, I'm surprised that they didn't go for it on 4th-and-1. Your thoughts?
I'm a little bit surprised, too. And you know, we have seen the trend so far this season where teams have been very aggressive. And really, it started a couple of years ago when Doug Peterson came to Philadelphia and all these analytical guys that he brought with him, and they were going for it on 4th down, going for 2-point conversions, and just kind of, you know, reshaped the game that we had become accustomed to playing for me and watching as well. So, you know, you watch teams now going for it. I mean, Andy Reid last week at his own 35-yard line coming out, goes for a 4th-and-1. So I think we're seeing a much more aggressive approach. And, you know, in talking to coaches around the league, what I hear from them is that they're trying to set a positive tempo, get their team in the right frame of mind. Guys, no matter what the situation, we're going for it. Jared Goff, 4th-and-1, quarterback sneak, seal the Seattle game. Don't give Russell Wilson the ball back. Teams are getting a message from their coach that we're going to play the Steel Herman Edwards line to win the game. Teams are much more aggressive in those situations because of the analytical people. And you have to have trust in your running game, in your quarterback, in your offensive line to execute those plays.
Yeah, I was just surprised, and you bring up the valid point here. It felt like Dallas was playing not to lose instead of, you know, the approach Sean McVay had on the road in Seattle is I don't know if my defense can stop Russell Wilson here. I don't want to take a chance. Let's go for it on 4th-and-1. And that was what was surprising with the Cowboys. And even Jerry Jones said, well, I don't want to second guess Jason Garrett, but we should have taken the risk. That's called second guessing your coach.
No question about it, and Dallas needs a spark right now. Yeah. They're not getting it. You got Ezekiel Elliott, arguably the best running back in the game. Although I think Saquon Barkley, if he had a decent offensive line, would be shredding this league right now. But that being said, you know you can't play not to lose. That's the old school way the NFL was. If you watch the Chiefs now and the Rams and what they're doing and the aggressive approach, that's the new NFL. The rules allow the game to be played that way, so you have to be aggressive.
Yeah, I think it's the Doug Peterson effect on the NFL, as you mentioned. Odell Beckham comes out prior to the game in an interview with the Mothership, and he questions Eli and questions his coach and questions whether he wants to stay in New York, and then takes credit for the Giants playing a competitive game against Carolina. What do you make of this, Jaws?
Well, I think Odell Beckham, you just ought to play football. I think the guy is a tremendous football player. But football is the consummate team game. And once you wreck that locker room, you wreck the team. And he's well on his way to accomplishing the goal.
Yeah, I was just disappointed. Why don't you go to Eli and say, how do I make you better? Or, you know, you go to your coach and you talk to him of, what can I do? And that I don't know what this does. I don't know how this helps when you say you're not sure about your future there and you're not sure if your quarterback, you know, in your quarterback and how that could possibly help you. Like Eli went out and had a great game, what, to prove Odell Beckham wrong? I'm trying to understand the logic of something that's very selfish.
Yeah, no question, Dan. And football is the consummate team game. There is no I in team. You must play the game, particularly on the field, all 11 guys executing it one time. You know, and I will be honest with you. I always am. I've had coaches call me into their office. I've played for some great coaches. The coach I played for won close to 1,000 games in the National Football League. When you look at, you know, Dick Vermeil and Don Shula and Chuck Knox and Marty Schottenheimer, to name a few of those guys. And I can remember being called up into their office for things that I said to the media, on television, in the newspaper. And very few times that I have to be called up for my play on the field, but coaches need to get their players under control. And I did have some loose lips at times. I'll be the first to admit it. And it got me in trouble. But, you know, the coach always was the one that rectified that problem.
The Rams, I thought they were going to lose that game. Going into it, I thought Seattle was going to beat them. But, you know, they survived there, and that's all you have to do. And obviously with the 4th-and-1 play. But looking at this, it feels like that division, you know, winning that game in Seattle means they're going to win that division and win it handily. Maybe there was no doubt there. But your thoughts on, you know, the Rams' long haul here, the bigger picture here. You got any questions about that defense?
Yeah, after yesterday's performance, I do, and they have not been consistent, and obviously they've invested a lot of money in, you know, in Aaron Donald and Ndamukong Suh on that defensive line, but as a unit, they've been getting pushed around a little bit. People have been able to move the football on them, but what's going to help the Rams as the season wears on is their offense. I mean, it is literally unstoppable. Even after, you know, losing your first and second best receivers, they're still able to move the football and maintain offense, and you know, what's going to happen is they're going to get leads in games. They're going to force teams to play catch-up and get in that known passing situation. And if the defense knows you have to throw the football, man, what they can do schematically in that secondary and linebackers and blitzes make it very, very difficult. So I think the Rams will figure it out defensively as they go on. I think although Kansas City's playing good football, yeah, I would say right now the Rams are the team to beat.
Well, speaking of the Chiefs with Mahomes, and you break down as much tape, if not more, than anybody, what is Patrick Mahomes' weak spot here that defenses are going to try to hone in on?
You know, it's amazing. I haven't looked at the tape from yesterday's game yet. I will probably within the next couple hours, but I've looked at his previous games. And we all see the playmaking ability. The guy, when he was coming out, I thought he would be good. I never thought he'd be this good. I thought he was a little bit erratic. I thought the accuracy, you know, because the big arm guys used to take longer to develop the touch passes. He has done that. The one thing that I won't say it jumps out, but what would concern me a little bit is because he can run, he does. And quarterbacks that can run will bolt out of the pocket prematurely. They won't stay with their progression. But what he's able to do is when he does move out of the pocket, set, reset, and throw the football with uncanny accuracy and velocity and anticipation. So he's doing all those little things. But, you know, as good as he's playing, I think he's going to get a lot better.
And I'm watching Deshaun Watson last night. I mean, you got to have self-preservation here. I don't know why these quarterbacks think that, you know, these injuries only happen to other quarterbacks. And Deshaun Watson, I don't know how he lasts the entire season. I don't need you to be a tough guy. I want you to be there for 16 games, not take on a defensive back on a run for, you know, 2 yards.
You know, Dan, I think I may have mentioned you when we were talking about Carson Wentz over the past year, you know, and people talk about, you know, advice you give quarterbacks. And I talk to guys and, you know, what should quarterbacks do? And I have a pretty common phrase that I use, say, put in some Peyton Manning tape, you know, and watch Peyton, because when the pocket was collapsing around him, he wasn't trying to fight for a yard or two. Yes, he would move around the pocket and let someone uncover, but Peyton was, you know, he'd go down. He wasn't going to take that hit because availability is more important than ability. You've got to be on the field. And Deshaun Watson, you know, his season ended last year. It's going to end again this year if he doesn't protect himself.
Good to visit with you, Jaws, as always. We appreciate your time. Thank you.
Always great with you. Breaking down on a Monday morning, Dan.
Thank you, Jaws. That's Ron Jaworski, former ESPN analyst.
For more Dan Patrick Show, tune to Audience Channel 239 on DirecTV or download the Dan Patrick Show app.